the lights go on again. Ships will sail again, all over the world. Then we'll have time for things like wedding rings, and free hearts will sing when the lights go on again.
Welcome to War Memories. Welcome all people remember the Second World War. I'm Rod Gragg, and we're pleased on this program to have as our guest Colonel Burris Woodward of Conway, who has a long and distinguished career in the military going back to World War II. At the time of Pearl Harbor, Colonel Woodward was a senior at Conway High School, graduated in 1942, went to Clemson to study electrical engineering, but after a semester at Clemson, the draft age was lowered. He volunteered for the Army Air Corps, did his basic training in Miami Beach and more training in Pennsylvania, Tennessee, Alabama, Florida. In early 1944, he graduated as a pilot and a second lieutenant in the Army Air Corps. And by January of 1945, in the war's last year, he was in Europe assigned to a fighter squadron of the 9th Air Force based in Belgium. He flew 30 missions in a P-47 Thunderbolt, and he rose to rank as first lieutenant. And Colonel Woodward, it's a pleasure to have you on our program.
Thank you, Rod. Appreciate that.
Do you remember your first mission as a fighter pilot in World War II?
Very definitely. I don't remember the target or anything like that, but the main thing I was concerned was taxiing out, and when I lined up on the runway was a PSP, a steel mat runway, and we were carrying 500-pound bombs. And being the first mission and not knowing what was ahead, my feet were shaking on the controls, and I was scared, as was most of the new pilots that were on the mission. And after we got airborne, there was no problem, and we went out and performed the mission, and everybody got back safely. But it was something in the unknown, and I was right shook up about
it. Well, I would imagine if most people riding on top of a 500-pound bomb, their knees would be knocking as well as their feet shaking.
Well, I was green. I was 20 years old at the time.
Mm. And, well, now, you grew up in Horry County in Conway, and were a senior in high school when the war began. And I guess when you heard the news of Pearl Harbor and everything started happening, you never imagined yourself flying with a 500-pound bomb out of Belgium to go bomb Germany, did you?
No, certainly didn't. I assumed that the war would be over reasonably fast and that it would not involve me at all. And, but I was wrong.
Well, you were a kid when the war began, but you had to grow up really quickly, didn't you?
Yeah, sure did. I was not the youngest person in my squadron. There were some that were actually 19 years old that were flying the same missions at that time. And they just got through training maybe a little faster than I did.
Mm-hmm. Well, you left Conway, and you went through all this training, and then you found yourself on that first mission. And I guess that had to have some sense of drama attached to it after all that training you'd gone through for more than a year.
Yeah.
And now you're finally over there and you're taking off on that first mission. And the thing that sticks in your memory the most is you wanted to get airborne.
Yeah. I think most of the pilots at that time felt like, you know, they could conquer the world and the thing. And we were young and really thought we could do anything. And I think that's probably one of the things why we were so effective over there. We were young enough to take chances that maybe at older age we wouldn't have taken.
Mm-hmm.
And but we had my CO of my outfit, who was a major at the time that I was in it, was 23 years old. And
Well, and I've heard that not only from veterans were they more willing to take chances because they were young, but early in their experience, they would take more chances than they would later in their experience after they became seasoned.
Yeah. That's true.
You got wise to the ways of war, I guess.
Yeah. The missions, most of the missions were very similar in that we dive bomb and strafed. And we saw a lot of flak, which is the enemy ground fire. And, first, most of us didn't even know what it was. We could see the flashes out there and just didn't understand it, but we learned to evade real fast.
Mm-hmm. And, well, you found yourself over there wearing something that looked like this, and you brought us this. This is your leather helmet that you actually wore as a fighter pilot in World War II. And you had to plug in. You had to learn a lot to get up in the air. A lot of training, a lot of work, and learning a lot about gear and a lot of things, I guess.
That's true. The flying part of it was real interesting. The ground school was not overly hard, but it was new to all of us, so that did require a lot of study and preparation. But we had a few that washed out along the way. Some of them washed out in the flying, and a few of them washed out in the ground school phase. But most of them got over and did real good. Mm-hmm. We had some of the people that came in the squadron at the time I went in, and later that were killed. We had one boy that came in and was killed on his first mission, and which was, you know, real sad. But and we don't.
How did that happen?
That was a dive bombing mission, and the pilots that were in there and came back said that they never pulled out, just went straight on in the ground. And our CO, who was Colonel Blackman, he was killed, Major Blackman at that time, he was killed on a ground strafing mission. He was shot down at low altitude, and he was killed in the crash.
Well, by early 1945, when you went into air combat in over Germany, Hitler's Nazi forces, which had conquered Europe, had been pushed back on all fronts, east, west.
That's true.
And had been pushed back to Germany. And even though they had lost a lot of their air support and so on, they were, by that time, defending their homeland. And that was a pretty furious defense because it was their homeland.
It was. They were moving back fairly fast, but they were real good at defending themselves as they retreated. And there was a lot of firepower still going on. It was Air Force was pretty much, the Hitler's Air Force was pretty much grounded and destroyed at that time, and there wasn't not too much danger from that. Mm-hmm. But it was a ground fire that the pilots were looking out for.
Well, at that time in the war, what was over Germany, what was a fighter, American fighter pilot's greatest fear? The flak?
Flak, yes. Mm-hmm. After the Allied armies had gotten Hitler across a pushback, they were stopped at the at a little town called Wesel, Germany. I believe that was on the Danube River. But the day that they massed, well, both sides massed all of the military hardware and everything up there. And that morning, I flew three missions that morning. We took off before daylight, and in this little town of Wesel, Germany, we dropped our bombs, and I'd say probably about 9 o'clock, the Allied armies or Allied Air Force started dropping their bombs in there. And that went on probably for 15 minutes, just the most bombardment that you can imagine. And then the artillery on the ground started firing. And the artillery, our artillery, we had so much of it there that you'd look down and the whole highway would shoot their guns at one time into this little town. And about 10 o'clock, the C-47 started in. C-46 is bringing paratroopers. The paratroopers were dropped on this little town of Wesel and right adjacent to it. The C-47s were towing gliders. They brought in support vehicles with the gliders. And of course, at that time, the Germans, they evidently dug in this little town and around it. They started firing back. And actually, we thought that the people in that town, everyone would have been dead from what had gone in there. But we established a crossing ahead across the river. And from then on, it was fairly easy to get on in toward Berlin.
Mm-hmm. And, what was it like to fly into a field of flak? You could see it from a distance?
Well, you'd try, some of it you could. Now, the small arms you couldn't, but the 40-millimeter flak generally had tracers in it, and you could see those, and it looked like a golf ball on fire coming at you. And if you saw it, you'd try to dodge it, and most of the time it'd stream by behind you, scare you, but it didn't hit. I never got hit by any flak, and lucked out.
But you could see these puffs of black smoke? Or?
Yeah. We saw a lot of the bombers on that particular day that they were going to the west. A lot of the bombers got hit. They would, of course, they flew in fairly close formation, and they could not maneuver as easy as we could. So they Germans would just fire their flak up into the formation, and it would knock them down. And there's a lot of times we'd see the parachutes open, and a lot of times we wouldn't.
What's the feeling you have when you're flying in a fighter and you see an American bomber with knowing it's got a full crew fall? I mean, you can actually see it hit and fall.
You feel for them, for sure. But really, at that time, you're looking after yourself, and it's just fewer away from it.
You're busy.
On the thing. I mean, you always feel sorry for any of them like that, but there's really nothing you can do about it.
But you could actually see the aircraft fall out of the formation?
And yeah, it'd fall out, and a lot of times if it was actually hitting an engine and destroyed, they would pull off, and if it was something that they could cope with, they'd fly the plane back. But if it was on fire, then they would bail out, and you'd try to count the people bailing out, the numbers that got out of it. And so,
what was your most memorable mission?
I think the first one was probably the most memorable, but some of the other ones, I strafed troops one time. We were in an area that we knew our forces weren't there, and we saw the German troops. We crawled into the place we were being controlled by, and we were ordered to go ahead and strafe, which we did.
And they were deploying or moving
they
in
were,
a column or what?
No, they were, I guess, retreating at that time along a major highway there, and with their equipment, and we were told to go ahead and fire on them, which we did.
What did they do when you came in?
They tried to get into the ditches and stuff like that. They scattered, but you know, when you're shooting 850 caliber machine guns and strafing, you're putting out a lot of bullets, and so it was, you kill people, and that's unfortunate, but you do.
That's what the purpose is in war, and in a desperate war like World War II, where you had good versus evil in a very real way. I mean, that's how it had to be done. But that had to be a difficult. It'd be hard too.
Well, it's hard, but really at the time, I don't think that anybody feels any tinge of guilt. I mean, myself. I mean, I felt like I was doing what I was over there for, and it was something you do. But it's never really worried me. You know, I remember about it, but I don't worry about it.
And you, at that time. Of course, you had the knowledge that when you were in battle like that, the more successful you were, the fewer American lives were going to be lost.
That's true.
So how many passes typically would you make in a situation like that?
On something like that, probably two. We never went back, went back and strafed an airfield over one time. You try to go in, make your pass, and get out, because generally if you stayed to make a second pass, you got shot down. And they had all of their airfields, most of their railroads and cities well armed with anti-aircraft type weapons.
At the time you went there in early 1945, this was not long after the Battle of the Bulge.
That's true.
Which was Hitler's last great, it was his great counteroffensive against American troops, which took the Allies by surprise in the winter and the snow. He also had infiltrated American lines with German soldiers in American uniforms to create confusion. And there was actually a massacre of American prisoners that the Germans had caught at Malmedy. So what was the attitude among American troops at the time you went over there toward the Germans, the German troops?
We were trying to kill as many of them as we could. I mean, it was get on with the war, get it over with. But I think really that most Americans, and I know I would have if you could have captured one alive, you'd do that, but you wouldn't take a chance on it otherwise.
Mm-hmm. American veterans say the Germans were good fighters.
Excellent fighters, yeah. In fact, their pilots were well trained too, and I've met some of the German pilots after the war over in Germany, and also later when I was recalled at Williams Air Force Base out there, we had German pilots that flew in World War II that came back to get checked out in jet planes. And of course at that time things had changed a lot. Mm-hmm. But some of them were very much veterans. I remember one officer that was at Williams Air Force Base that flown in Germany, who had been caught in a fighter plane that was on fire, and his face was just one huge scar. But he had a bunch of metal, Iron mm-hmm. Cross and everything. But
when you meet those German veterans, it's really the whole thing, I guess, wasn't personal. It was a professional approach.
No, most of the time you talk with them and have a drink with them if you're at the bar, and we were doing the same thing, and it's fighting the same type of battles and stuff, and it was interesting to mm-hmm. both of us.
Mm-hmm. What do you think was your closest call as a fighter pilot in World War II?
I don't remember any specific one, but it would probably, when you were in an area doing the dive bomber strafing with the flak coming in, I don't remember any other thing.
Mm-hmm. That gets the adrenaline flowing.
Yeah. I have a friend in Iowa that called me some years back. We had a reunion of our fighter squadron at Hickory Knob State Park, and it was the first time that I had gotten together with any of the guys from that period of time, and I was planning to go to it, and a few days before we were supposed to meet down there, this boy called my home, got my address, and my wife answered the phone, and I was away, and he asked her if I was around, and they got to talk, and he told her who he was, and said, "He saved my life in World War II," and he says, I want to see him again. So anyway, she asked me about it when I got home, and I said, "Well, I don't remember that at all." So anyway, we met at Hickory Knob State Park, and he's a eye doctor, optometrist in Burlington, Iowa. But anyway, we were talking. I said, "I want to know something." I said, "How did I save your life in World War II?" He said, "Well," he says, "we were on a strafing mission." He said, "That day I was leading the Element, which is a two-ship formation." He says, "And you were flying wing on me." And he says, "I was going down strafing." And he says, "I'd about to fly into the trees." And he said, "You all told me to pull up." And he says, "If I hadn't pulled up," he said, "I'd have gone straight in." I said, "Well, I'm glad to know how I saved your life," but I don't remember it at all.
You didn't remember, but he did.
Yeah, he remembered.
That's not the kind of thing you'd forget if you were doing that. That P-47 Thunderbolt was really a workhorse type of airplane, wasn't it?
Yeah, it was a real rugged, tough airplane, very, very tough.
Mm-hmm.
We had one man in the flight that actually flew into the side of a wooded hill on a mission. And he got out of the thing and was back flying a couple of days later. And most of the airplanes now, that happened, you probably wouldn't walk away from.
Was it constructed more heavily than a typical fighter?
Yeah, and it had the big radial engine in the front of it, which would take a lot of punishment. They've had actually cylinders shot off of the engine, and it would still run enough to get you back home. P-51 had a radial engine in it, and a bullet in it would generally cause the engine to lock up because of the oil and the coolant that would mm-hmm. drain out of it. But the radial engine was a better engine, mm-hmm. you know, to have in the airplane.
What kind of firepower did you have?
We had 8 50 caliber machine guns, and then it would carry, it had capacity to carry three bombs. Two is generally the most that I carried. I've carried 2,000 to 1,000 pound bombs on it, but that was a pretty good load for the plane.
Well, a Thunderbolt really wasn't designed to be a bomber. It was designed to be an escort fighter, correct?
High altitude escort fighter.
And how do you think it came to be used as a dive bomber?
Because it was so rugged and take such punishment. Actually, the 51 was a little faster and a little longer range, and it really was better for escort work than the 47. And the 47, of course, filled in as the low altitude fighter bomber.
Mm-hmm. So you flew 30 missions, so how often would you tend to fly missions?
We flew, if I say flew in the morning group, I'd be off that afternoon and the next morning and fly the following afternoon. The squadron was kind of divided in half as to the time you fly. Sometimes I'd fly two missions in one day, and that would be about it.
Mm-hmm.
I found out later that my 30 missions was actually about 10 missions more than some of the pilots that came in the squadron the same time I did. Mm-hmm. And I don't know how that happened, just scheduling.
Mm-hmm.
But that was.
Would you describe for me the lifestyle when you weren't in the air on these missions? Where were you billeted? What did you do in your time?
In Belgium, when I first joined the squadron, the squadron was stationed out at, of course, at the airfield as far as the enlisted personnel and maintenance people. The headquarters was at the field, and it was in tents or metal buildings, Quonset huts and things like that. The pilots, we were billeted in a schoolhouse in the town of Watershed. And of course, 20 years old and everybody thinking, well, you might get shot down or killed. Things were pretty free and easy. We had a bar, which most everybody partook of. We had a mess hall right in the place. We'd have a party generally on Saturday night, and we'd invite anybody. Well, in fact, a lot of the people in the town came out to our parties, and you met the local people too.
Belgians.
Belgian people. Mm-hmm. That was real interesting.
And how did the Belgians feel about Americans at this point?
There was a language problem there on the thing, but they were glad to see the American people in there, though I think a lot of them had collaborated on the thing and with the Germans. Watershed, Belgium was not too far from Aachen, Germany, and of course Aachen was flattened by our ground forces and bombers and everything too. But there was some damage in the little town that I was stationed at that time.
Mm-hmm. But American troops in the Air Force, well equipped, well supplied, well fed.
Yeah, in fact, in the schoolhouse, we had good food. We had a homemade bread. We had a baker that traveled with us, and even had a ice cream served a couple of times a week. It was made right there in the kitchen and the thing.
Well, was it hard to go from that kind of environment where you're, let's say you're having a good meal and some ice cream for a dessert, and you got a party coming up on Saturday, and then in a few minutes you're going to be up in a Thunderbolt with a 1,000-pound bomb under you, and you're going out to try to shoot up a locomotive, a train, or of troops, or yeah. How do you make that transition?
Well, the one thing, we didn't leave the bar to go fly the mission. We had the party. We might have a party every Saturday night, but the group that was flying the next morning was not permitted to
right.
Partake of the.
But you're in
party.
Essence back there. You're
yeah.
You're having what
yeah.
would amount to be a somewhat of a normal lifestyle,
yeah. That's right.
And eating well and enjoying your friendships, and
yeah.
then all of a sudden you're out
yeah.
there with your life on the line.
I don't think we ever. I don't think at the time that anybody really ever worried too much about it. I don't believe there's any big thought given to the fact you might not come back or something like that. You took your fun, which if it be called fun at that time, you took it when you could and entertained yourself. And of course, if you were not doing it, you're in a new and strange place. And I know I've made a lot of pictures and stuff, you know, the airfield and around town and stuff like that, and you tried to learn as much about the area as you could. And
well, at the time you were there, at the end of the war, Hitler introduced the first jet in combat, which was a German invention called the 262, I believe. And his Luftwaffe Air Force people wanted to use it as a fighter, which was what it was designed for, but he wanted to use it as a bomber, and so it never really was so effective. Yeah. But you saw some of those, and they were supposed to be really incredible aircraft for their day.
Most of the ones I saw was after the war on at Castle Air Force Base over there. That was a kind of experimental place, and a lot of these planes were there. And some, most of them were disassembled. There were some that were assembled, and they didn't have enough really at that time, I don't believe, to have affected our Air Force. I'm not real sure that the 262 was better than the P-51, because the 51s did shoot down a few of the 262s over there, but we were never bothered with any of their jet planes to any degree. And of course, I don't think any of them really were flying very long after I got over there, because the war was winding down anyway.
Do you remember your last mission? Were you counting
those
things?
Actually, it was not a combat. I got credit for being a combat mission, but the war was winding down, and we had been told, you know, it was just a matter of a day or two they would announce the armistice. But they sent the squadron down to a prisoner of war camp just to buzz the thing to kind of build up the morale of the prisoners in there. And we flew down, and I think it was 12 or 16 airplanes went down. And of course, those planes, they were not guarded as far as flak or anything, and we came across that. And you know, you tried to outdo your other pilot friends, you know. And so I think everybody there came across and pulled up rolling, you know, as far as you could. And it was a fun time, really. And you could see the prisoners, they were all outside and waving, and he felt pretty good about the thing. And
well, after 30 missions, you deserve to feel pretty good on the last one. Well, after the war ended, you remained in the Air Force. You became a jet pilot, remained in active duty till 1947. 1949, you married Vivian Wood of Denmark, South Carolina. You came back to Conway for a while, then went back to active duty in the Korean War, served in Vietnam as a forward air controller, assistant air liaison officer. You rose to the rank of major and later to lieutenant colonel in the reserves. You won the Distinguished Flying Cross in Vietnam, Air Commendation Medal. And finally, in 1970, you retired and returned to Conway, where you now live. And we're glad you made it through, and it was an honor to have you on this program.
Thank you very much. It's good to be here.
And thank you, too, for joining us for War Memories. Waccamaw people remember the Second World War.
The preceding program was brought to you in part by the Conway National Bank.